Hey there, everyone. Well, it's open topic week this week, and I thought I'd talk about how we perceive ourselves as responding to stress or discrimination and what is actually happening, because I noticed the difference this week. When I was young and well into my adulthood, I had this completely irrational fear of moths. And when I was a child, I think I had this thing in my head that they were dead butterflies because of their dusty wings. So I thought they were like ghosts flying about the place. But this does not explain why I continued with this phobia into adulthood. And I would do things like turn on the lights because so the moths would fly to the light, and then I could close the door because I couldn't sleep with a moth in the room. Now, I had had no bad experiences with moths. I mean, not that many people, I don't even know of any, actually I know one person that has had a bad experience of moths, and that was one became trapped in their ear and it was deafening. But like, that could happen with any insect, right? And then, so this was, it was a completely irrational phobia that I seemed to have no control over. And then when I moved to Sydney, there was a bogon moth plague. There were moths everywhere. There were moths on the street, moths on the windscreen, moths on the windows, moths on the top of the car. There were street sweepers used to clear the bogon moths off the runways. It was just covered in bogon moths. And from that point forward, my phobia disappeared. Not only was I just not bothered by moths, I actually began to quite like them and find the patterns on their wings very interesting. And even now, like, I'll attempt to try and save them if they fly into water and things. And because this was not a phobia on the level of that, you know, impacts on people's lives the way some phobias do, I sort of hadn't realized that I no longer had this phobia. And then I was talking to someone about it one day, and they said they'd done some psychology thing, and they said that's immersion therapy. You know, if you immerse yourself in something, you acclimatize to it, you become accustomed to it, and your fear wanders off. And I found, you know, I was like, okay. And to some degree, I felt this way about the lived experience of discrimination, because like from a very young age, we were really fortunate. We were taught, you know, you must not carry the world's fear. It's not yours. You do not own it. You have enough of your own fear. It's too big. You can never carry it even if you try. Leave what is not yours be. Leave it there, you know. And also because on the immersion theory, like, I've experienced discrimination both indirect and direct for my entire life. Like, I often just am not bothered by it. It is like just a daily experience. It's like whatever, I'm very removed from it. As I said, I was very fortunate. We were taught as children, you don't carry it. So when the marriage equality survey came up, and, it, you know, you have to keep in mind it's now October. This started in September and will not finish till November. I was more concerned about the stress this would place on vulnerable members of the LGBT community. I was most worried about what it was doing to the children of LGBT people. And even though I thought it would irritate the hell out of me, I didn't actually think it would have an internal impact. And I was wrong, it has. And that's fine in itself, except what is not fine is that I didn't recognize it. And we had this thing, you know how I volunteer for this LGBT youth group, and amongst those kids there are some parents that are highly supportive, wonderful, just astounding people that I admire very much. And then there are some parents that they're there, they're present, and as in those children's lives to some degree, often quite removed, but they're still there. They haven't left entirely, but they're not supportive. And then we have children in that group who unaccompanied as such, so family's not in the picture at all. And I was talking to this middle group, about some parents in this middle group that are still about and are now experiencing difficulty with the situation they find themselves in. And I am always highly diplomatic. I only make very generalized comments because ultimately, in my mind, I'm there for the kids. With keeping in mind, I mean, excluding duty of care, I want to protect their confidentiality. And also in terms of their parents, I want to build bridges, not go making anything worse. Because these are the group of people that are a captive audience that perhaps given time that will be all right, you know. And one of them, and in the end, I don't even know how we got around to this, but they said, you know, that their main worry is that they have done something wrong that has resulted in their child being LGBT, that they have failed in their parenting skills. Now, normally I would respond to this in a highly generalized diplomatic manner, but because I'd been under this pressure that I hadn't recognized for well over a month now, I just lost it. And they happened to be the people that were unfortunate enough to be in that space at that time. And I was just like, look, if you want to worry about bad parenting skills, you know, abandoning your child is bad parenting skills. Your child not knowing that you love them unconditionally is bad parenting skills. Not attempting to support your child so they join the other 2,800 LGBTI Australians who have taken their own lives this year, that's bad parenting skills, you know. Having an LGBT child is not something you chose and it's not something they chose, and that is not bad parenting skills. And as soon as it came out of my mouth, and I was much more like, I really did, I was just angry. I thought, oh no. And it wasn't that I didn't believe what I was saying, and it wasn't that it wasn't true. It's that you get more bees with honey. Anyway, so I waited, like, you know, I recognized it straight away, because when I'm at work, because we work in service delivery, if I'm not okay internally, I'm really careful about what I do. Like, I actually go to work with this intention in my mind that I'm not going to make any major decisions today. And if I absolutely have to, I'm going to go and get a second opinion, you know. So it's not that I'm not conscious of this, but I was just not conscious of this coming at all. And then I was like, wow, okay, this is having an impact on me. I can't do this postal survey number. I have to remove myself. And I rang the, in terms of the damage that I did in this situation, I got off lightly. I think I rang the coordinator and I said, look, this is what I said. And, you know, I'm concerned about the impact on their child and I shouldn't have done it and da 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 da. And they said, relax. They said, you know what? They said they've actually just turned up to the their first PFLAG meeting. They're extremely nervous, but they've gone in the door. And like they were saying that, the supervisor was saying that they were just shocked when they saw them, like, please shocked. So I guess the outcome was okay. But, like, also then I'm thinking, oh, my God, did I bully them into that? Like, you know, like, whatever, you know. But at least it didn't swing in the other direction, which it quite easily could have. So, yeah, I'm not quite sure. I guess I'm just explaining to you what's been going on in an LGBT sense in my head. But if you are in Australia and you are being exposed to this, take stock. Don't just think, like me, we're all old enough and ugly enough and we've done all this before and whatever. Anyway, I'm going to get out of here. I'll see you all next week. Bye for now.